presented, following by our chosen moderator, who is a very dear friend, Professor Andrew Ullman. Andrew, it's a great pleasure to see you. And as you all may know, Andrew Ullman, as for Unite, he is our chapter chair for Western and Central Europe, but he has become very well known for his work as a member of the Bundestag throughout the pandemic, very important leader of the FDP, and has recently started important negotiations for the future government of Germany. I wish you all the best and success. And I know that you have the heart, your heart in the right place, fighting for the people of your country, but also for global health at large. And we're very proud to be associated also with you and have you as a member of Unite and moderating here today. I'd also like to greet my dear friend, Roland Gund, from the German Health Alliance. And also I'd like to greet you for your leading initiative on the Virchow Foundation for Global Health, which was presented yesterday by Professor Detlef Ganten, and of which I am proud to also be a member of the Board of Trustees. It's certainly one more step in your important leadership in global health. So thank you for that. And a very warm welcome to all of the panelists, and particularly to civil society partners such as Frontline Aids that are online, who are always the ones at the end of the day for whom parliamentarians work for, as we are representatives of the people. So Unite is a network of parliamentarians that spreads out to nearly 90 countries and with over 200 MPs. And the truth is that Unite was actually created from the World Health Summit following a session in which the idea came about, working with UNAIDS in 2016, and we were founded in 2017. And we started off focusing very much on HIV and AIDS, viral hepatitis and TB, but we have expanded to communicable diseases. At the time, pandemic preparedness and response was a core issue, but at the time it was just theory. It has become very practical throughout the year, these last year and a half. And we have now shifted to even broader issues that are related to global health, in which digital health plays a pivotal role in transforming the landscape towards generating even more value from our health systems and health-related institutions, and the importance of representatives in congresses, in senates, in parliaments around the world is of critical importance. Unite is one of the few parliamentary networks out there that is focusing so strongly on digital health. And that's why we felt that this initiative was so important to have this discussion at the World Health Summit, having a discussion around the ethical, moral, and economical debate on how digital health innovations will increase or should increase equity and justice, in particular for those that are in most vulnerable situations. It is a global network, and our work in digital health is to bring policymakers, best practices, and leaderships across the board, across the globe, to implement clear national roadmaps to standardize and to make sure that we are able to achieve the political action plans where we can channel how digital health can achieve better health and well-being for all. Digital health, in our view, is not an end per se. It is actually a means towards which we should achieve the UN Sustainable Development Goals. And working with Unite, but in partnership with the Parliamentary Network on the World Bank and IMF, we have just founded the International Forum on Global Health, which is a federation of 14 parliamentary networks from around the world, of which more networks are open to join. And hopefully we are creating the platforms needed so that we can provoke the transformations that are needed on the global health stage. We're very excited because we believe that through digital, we will be able to achieve our goals of ending infectious diseases as a global health threat. And as we normally say, it's time to unite. To end, I'd like to call my dear friend, Roland Gund, to say a few words also on behalf of the German Health Alliance. Thank you very much.
Yeah, my dear friend Ricardo, Dear Mr. Ephraim Gomez, dear Professor Andrew Ullmann, esteemed panelists, ladies and gentlemen, also on behalf of GHA German Health Alliance, a multi-sectoral initiative with 120 member companies and organizations, I would like to warmly welcome you to this session. And I remain very grateful for having the opportunity to co-organize this session jointly with UNITE and UNAIDS. It's not only one of the most important lessons learned from the ongoing pandemic, but rather in general, for the sake of a sustainably thriving socio-economic development to the benefit of our global community, strengthening health systems and a fundamentally effective key for this timely, but I'm well used to the regulations, obviously. So rather in general, for the sake of a sustainably thriving socio-economic development to the benefit of our global community, strengthening health systems and as fundamentally effective key for this timely implementation of science and research triggered innovations in technologies, products, solutions, services, and processes for a quality oriented health infrastructure must be continuously positioned at the top of our joint agenda. And undoubtedly, digital health innovation is playing a very dynamically increasing, crucial, and successful role in effecting a major contribution to the urgently required significant improvements and transformative changes towards needs-based and resilient health systems with the best possible prevention and non-discriminatory access, leaving no one behind. Of course, also in order to be better prepared and equipped globally and in global equity for the next pandemic. During yesterday's opening ceremony, you all have heard from Dr. Tedros in his keynote that the next World Health Summit in October 2022 will be shaped as a joint World Health Summit WHO Global Health Conference, aiming to welcome more than 5,000 participants on site in Berlin, plus a virtual presence at large scale. And this truly will mark a new milestone in the evolution of the World Health Summit. And this may shape a new milestone of decisively important exchange and fruitful cooperation within the global health community across disciplines, sectors, borders, and continents, especially when certain prerequisites will be matched. To my perspective, this specifically includes two elements. Firstly, the unique strengths and assets of the World Health Summit above all its openness toward the actors in global health from all sectors and disciplines. And this need to be consequently maintained and well used, also and especially in such form of a joint WHO conference format. Secondly, the crucial role and responsibility of policymakers in global health needs to be considered at much larger scale, and as well at larger scale policymakers from around the globe who are committed to and engaged in expertise in global health should be more actively invited and participate at the World Health Summit. I'm convinced that by the example of digital health innovation we are discussing today, this role and the need for a wider exchange with an active involvement of parliamentarians will be impressively underlined. And if this will be taken into account and done right, the next year World Health Summit may very successfully shape a new level of the so much needed well-targeted action to jointly contribute toward the health-related UN 2030 Agenda Sustainable Development Goals. With the words of my sincere cordial gratitude towards UNITE and UNAIDS as long-term partners and friends, as well as to our moderator, Professor Ullmann, and truly one of the champions in German parliamentarian global health engagement. And of course, to all our speakers, I'm now wishing all of us a highly interesting, inspiring round of inputs and following an insightful, fruitful, open discussion. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for your very kind attention.
Dear Ricardo Baptista, dear Roland Goethe, thank you very much for those opening remarks. And I'm really proud and happy that we are here sitting together despite a pandemic that is still raging around the world, causing a lot of haywalk in Germany, in Europe, in the world. And we are still fighting this pandemic together. And I'm very proud that we could see each other now in three dimensions, not only on the screen, outside, and a very warm welcome to you here in Berlin and to the panelists and to everybody here in the audience and for those who are online. Without further ado, we have a couple of panelists who will give opening remarks before we start the discussion. And I would like to present the first speaker who's going to give us a keynote lecture, Ephraim Gomez. He is Chief of Staff at UNAIDS. Mr. Gomez is previously the head of the United Nations Policy Department in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Sweden. And before that, a foreign policy advisor to Sweden's prime minister and head of the security policy department in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Sweden. So it sounds very Swedish. And your name is not really Swedish, but that really doesn't matter. And he will be presenting to us leveraging social innovations and technologies to achieve better health outcomes. Dear Mr. Gomez, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Andrew. I'm happy to join you here today as Chief of Staff, as you said, Andrew, of UNAIDS. I joined only about a year ago at UNAIDS. So really grateful and thankful for having me at this panel. I'm subbing for my executive director, Winnie Bianima. And so you will bear with me as I have a speech that is some opening remarks where we have some takeaways that I hope that you can, that will carry us also further into the next discussions. My key points will be about communities, multi-sectoral approach, and also about empowerment of women in innovations. But thank you, Andrew. Thank you, Ricardo, and also Adiba and Gabriela, Christoph and Roland. And also in particular, the German Health Alliance and UNITE. We have a very close collaboration at UNAIDS together with them. And just to set the context for this intervention, of course, is that we are living through one of the greatest challenges that we've had for many decades. COVID-19 exposed how fragile our gains have been over the several decades. And also potentially it showed both our crises brings to the fore our weaknesses and our strengths. But it's also highlighted the urgency for us to scale access to healthcare, without which we are just one pandemic away from the next, from a complete breakdown. And the inequities in healthcare access, it isn't just unacceptable in the moral sense, but it's also self-defeating in an economic and political way. It's one of the biggest threats that we have to achieving the SDGs, of course. And it's really telling that we don't have access to basic, one in two people globally don't have access to basic healthcare, and that it's every year 100 million more people fall into extreme poverty due to health costs. And of course that COVID-19, and we would notice at UNAIDS, epidemics thrive on inequalities. That is actually what drives them. And so, of course, I mean, we know the figures that only 5% in Africa have so far got their first shot, whereas we are debating the third booster shots in our parts of the world. And what we need to do, well, there's a tall list of things that we need to do. But one of the things, of course, is to rethink the models for healthcare delivery and leverage innovations that can be transformative. And my job here today in together with you is to draw on UNX experience from the AIDS movement and look at some key lessons for the broader health response. AIDS, just as a short reminder, has been one of the most deadly pandemics that we've had in the world. 77.5 million people have been infected with HIV, and 34.7 million people have died because of AIDS since the start of the epidemic. But we've had some incredible successes over the last 40 years since the epidemic was discovered or started. We have 75% of all people living with HIV are on treatment. That's 27.4 million people on treatment today. And we have reduced the AIDS death by 43% since 2010. And the AIDS response has been able to make this progress by turning an epidemic back by betting on innovations. And there's a range of different innovations, of course. One of them is social innovations, putting people at the center, relying on the lived experience of communities to design and co-create the AIDS response. This is particularly important today as we are in a formative moment on pandemic preparedness, that we acknowledge the importance of inclusion and also consultation from the inception of the different means, structures, institutions, et cetera, that we design. But we also called for pricing innovations, which is actually also relevant today. from moving the price of an ARVs, antiretrovirals, from over $10,000 per person per year to less than 75. Quite a few who said that this was impossible when we started, but that's where we are today. It's an important reminder. We also have bet on technology innovations. I mean, one of the clearest examples is that we've moved from 16 pills a day to one pill a day. That matters. To having a long-acting injectable. And then we have some institutional UNAIDS and also financial innovations that many of those are also sort of make part of the sort of lexicality as we now think about what we build up to long-term for pandemic preparedness. It could be the Global Fund or PEPFAR, et cetera, investments in the AIDS response. And of course, one of the things that has also been hotly debated, some think rightly, others think wrongly, about the TRIPS flexibilities. But maybe to my main three lessons that we've had on innovations. The first one is to put communities at the center. If there is one lesson that HIV offers, then it's the centrality of communities in the design and implementation of our health responses. The AIDS responses demonstrate that innovations driven by the passion of communities can transform healthcare access and reach the most marginalized. Innovation of any nature, if it's social, financial, or digital, whatever we want to achieve, if we don't once again keep the communities at the center, they will fail. And science needs to do its part, politics too, but then communities as well. We are acutely aware of many of the fantastic initiatives and technologies that have failed because they've been designed without stakeholders being co-creators and enablers. And so innovations need to empower communities to lead the response on the ground. That's irrespective of innovations being invented in Silicon Valley, Geneva, or Berlin. If they don't put people at the center, it's just a good idea that will struggle to thrive. And I mean, it's just a fact of life that if technology was the sole solution and it didn't, I mean, there's a strong difference between vaccines and vaccination. I mean, otherwise we would have reached the 20 targets by now. UNAIDS, we're proud to run the Health Innovation Exchange and we've spoken to 50, our last edition of that Health Innovation Exchange. We had over 50 ministers of health on why innovations and technologies are not being leveraged for scaling access. And nearly every one of them responded that it wasn't a lack of innovations, but lack of innovators understanding the pain points of the ministries. An important circumstance for us, of course, in leveraging innovations. My second point then is on the need for a multisectoral response. I mean, today, several of the solutions, we know this in the HIV movement, of course, is that many of the solutions for addressing healthcare challenges lie outside the health sector. For example, if 50 to 70% of the health facilities in sub-Saharan Africa do not have access to stable electricity, then we need to address this fundamental bottleneck to enable the use of digital health innovations. Telemedicine has shown huge potential for scaling access to healthcare during the COVID times. But if we don't have basic building blocks in place and break the silos within which we work, we will fail. With the rapidly increasing mobile connectivity and the low orbit satellites now being deployed, they provide better quality connectivity even in the remotest areas. And so we have the ability to think of scale like we've never done before, but we need to bring these sectors to work together to secure the future of health. I know from personal experience that it can feel a bit outside your comfort zone and a bit threatening, but you need to push yourself to those kinds of conversations, even if you think they're closer to sci-fi or something. But third, this is really not sci-fi. We need to put women's economic empowerment and empowerment generally at the center. We've learned in the AIDS response that if we don't address the gender and economic drivers of the epidemic, we continue to fail. Concretely, for UNAIDS, we need radical game changers for adolescent girls and young women in sub-Saharan Africa to address the persisting inequality, stigma, and discrimination that continue to be the principal driver of our epidemic in sub-Saharan Africa, and where the largest infection rates still are. And so innovations in health provides a huge opportunity to place women at the center. And the transition to digital health provides a huge opportunity to train the next generation of digital health workers. And health can also be an engine of employment for young women. And we have a unique generational opportunity to invest in this transition, of course. Well, some recommendations made sort of just to wrap up then for governments. One of our recommendations, or our strongest one, is of course that we should embrace innovations, but we need to have a rights-based approach as we do it, a community empowering approach as well. And so that we know that we will protect the rights of people and that we work with people and not against them. And of course, for the UN, there are many conclusions to draw, but we at UNAIDS, we continue to think that the UN needs to serve as a facilitator and trusted broker between health and other ministries, of course, and innovators of all types. And maybe if a word of reflection also, since I come most recently then from a very donorish role before I joined UNAIDS, is of course that, to be honest, there is a bit of a pilotitis within sort of, you go for a lot of pilots, but the real risk investments, we are still a bit behind as governments, and that can also be a bit frightening, but we need to take that leap of faith in innovations. And so to conclude, we stand really at the doorstep of what can be a radical transformation in the way that we work and deliver healthcare. And COVID, of course, has fast-tracked and the adoption and necessity to make this rapid shift, and also spurred our thinking and our ambitions, not least in HIV, to go for the cure. But we need to ensure that we don't miss this opportunity to make a world of difference for the people who are left behind. That is very present for us in the HIV fight. For many of them, it's a difference between, of course, health and ill health, and between life and death. And so science, innovation, rights, and community ownership, those have all helped us to reverse the AIDS pandemic, and they are essential for us to beat it, to beat AIDS also by 2030. And so we hope that we have some lessons as we march towards universal health coverage and health for all. So thank you so much. Over to you, Andrew.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ibrahim. There is room for one question now, but we'll go into the discussion later. If there's one urgent question here in the audience, just raise your hand. If not, we'll just go to the next panelist. I do not see anything. So thank you very much, because I think there's a lot of points that you mentioned we should discuss later on, and we'll have the chance for us to do so. Now, the next speaker I would like to announce to you is Professor Dr., and that's going to be a challenge for me here, Idibia Kamaru-Salman. I pronounce it 50% maybe correctly. She's president of the International AIDS Society, dean of the Faculty of Medicine at the University of Malaya in Malaysia. She's established an infectious diseases unit at the University of Malaya Medical Center and the Center of Excellence for Research in AIDS. She's president of the Malaysian AIDS Council from 2006 to 2010, where she remains an executive committee member until this date. She'll give us a short impulse on the topic, harvesting digital technology for HIV prevention and treatment.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you to the organizers for inviting me to speak at this session this afternoon. And following on from what Ephraim has just said, I think in the world of HIV, there's enormous opportunity to leverage on the advances of digital technology to get us to where we want to be, ending AIDS in by 2030. We, of course, coupled with the digital technology, we have had enormous advances, not just in antiretroviral therapy, but other preventive measures that coupled with digitization, I think, can bring these tools to where they're most needed. Let me just kind of walk you through some of the potentials in terms of how digitization can assist in implementing HIV prevention and treatment programs. First of all, in terms of diagnoses. And I think in this COVID-19 pandemic, we were kind of catapulted into thinking how best can we improve HIV self-testing, the first in the 1999, the HIV cascade. And I think many regions, many countries embrace the HIV self-testing model, which before, like Ephraim mentioned, were pilots all over the world. In Malaysia, for instance, where I come from and where, it's a conservative country where stigma and discrimination is still pretty deep, and patients kind of fear coming forward for testing, particularly if they belong to a certain key population. By having HIV self-testing as part of a model for them to access by ordering the test online or through an application, we were able to see, despite the COVID pandemic, an increase in HIV testing in Malaysia. So that's one example of using digital technology to improve HIV testing, even in the setting of lockdowns. The second, in terms of improving diagnosis, of course, and I think once again, many models have been tried in providing counseling online and also partner services, telemedicine and so forth. In terms of risk, in terms of prevention, risk reduction, again, risk reduction counseling and linkage to care can be provided through telemedicine. And wonderful examples of PrEP services around the world and around the region. I'm speaking about the Asian region, of PrEP services that have mushroomed during the COVID pandemic. And this is critical because we know that despite the successes of PrEP provision in developed countries, many developing countries are still, again, in pilot mode. And once again, I think the COVID pandemic has created an opportunity for many community-based organizations and health-based organizations to rethink how we can provide these essential services in a different model. And then finally, of course, treatment through once again telemedicine, but also through different models of care in developing countries where the healthcare workers' capacity building is still much needed. Another model of care using digital innovation, of course, would be the ECHO model that provides communities of practice that increases capacity in rural, in hard to reach regions and rural areas. So, once again, a model that needs to be scaled up so that hard to reach populations in rural areas and also vulnerable populations. For instance, even I work in a prison setting as well, and we're thinking of providing HIV care through telemedicine and the ECHO model in prisons across Malaysia. It's something that we're working on. So, many examples of digital technology and innovations that can escalate the many advances in HIV prevention and treatment. But of course, in many populations that are at risk of HIV or are affected by HIV, the concerns would be the data privacy as well as data security, which, if not properly thought about in terms of designing these digital innovations, can potentially put you know, people at risk of data getting into the wrong hands, where either HIV is criminalized or those at risk of HIV, for instance, in, you know, people who use drugs, MSM, sex workers can, you know, data can potentially get into the wrong hands and put these members of this key population at risk. So in terms of policymakers looking at expanding digital health to prevent and treat HIV/AIDS, just like what Ephraim was saying, it's important as they create these national models that it is designed with the community, together with the community, so that all these details around not just, you know, culturally appropriate and language appropriate, but the all important privacy and security that could actually mean, you know, between incarceration for certain members of the population. So perhaps with that, I end. And thank you very much once again for the invitation.
Adiba, thank you very much for these information and your notes, because I'm actually, that's how I personally started out in an HIV prison ward, not as a prisoner, but as a physician, of course. And I'm looking forward for your exchange that we compare our experiences. Is there a question to Adiba from the audience? I would allow one question, otherwise we'll go into the panel discussion later on where we could ask those questions. I do not see any hands, so I'll go with any further ado. The next speaker is going to be online, and I can see that she is online. Hello from Berlin. This is Louis Shigadu. She is Director of Evidence and Influence at Frontline AIDS. She is a leading Zimbabwean HIV specialist for more than 30 years on hands leadership experience on HIV, sexual and reproductive health and rights, gender activism, and civil society engagement. Now I got it right. And she'll give us an impulse on the role of communities in the digital health innovation. And Louis, just a question for you. Where are you right now?
In Cape Town, South Africa.
Okay, wonderful. Hello from to Cape Town, and the floor is yours.
Yes, greetings from South Africa. I really wish I was there with all of you, but I think the new norm and the new world we have now is that we can be in different places and still be able to dialogue. So this afternoon, I'm going to be talking about the role of communities in digital health innovation. I just want to start with a profound saying that I saw from an author called Viner, where describing the era that we are in and we are just coming out. I can't even say coming out, because where I'm sitting, we are still in the middle of the pandemic. There cannot be a person alive who has not been touched by the events of the past year. But the pandemic is simultaneously universal and infinitely particular. And it just brings to the fore for me how much has changed in the last year or so, ever since the COVID epidemic came onto us. And this has led to a lot of transformation that we have seen in the HIV response, as communities made serious efforts to innovate in order to respond to COVID-19. I just put this diagram there just to give you an idea. In this era that we call the new normal, we saw a huge acceleration in the shift to digital health systems. And what you see there are all the different, in the top 50 emerging digital health trends in 2021. And this is from the Medical Futurist. And what I found interesting, they kind of mixed all the different things happening at different time, but I am just really surprised by the numbers, the sheer numbers in new innovations that have emerged. However, when I look at what is happening, I want to ask the question of who is missing. We have the health technicians, the specialists who worry about the hardware. We have the digital health specialists, you know, the users, mostly the medical staff. And my question is, where is the community? And I want to straight away go into the role of the community. And so what I did was to look at the whole spectrum of digital innovation from the time of research and development and rollout. And they are important and critical points where the community can really play an important role if given the opportunity. So particularly on the research and design, the communities often find themselves as recipients and users of digital technology applications. And yet they can be fully involved during the research and design stages of the technology. What that would assist us that it can ensure that technologies are adaptable to different countries, contexts, and cultures to minimize resistance and ensure trust and access. And at the time of rollout of any innovation, the communities can play a critical role, particularly around digital health literacy, educating peer-to-peer education on how a particular technology works and how it can benefit the community. We can have digital health champions who can give feedback, who can mobilize communities, who can do advocacy and activism, and also promote the technology so that it can work in the way it is expected to work. We also have a role for communities around the issue of the development of national digital health strategies, frameworks, and policies. And as we know, WHO has strongly recommended that member states move into developing national strategies on digital health and frameworks and policies, and that they provide leadership. In this particular process, it's very important to have communities in the room because then they can inform the strategies and make sure that the strategies do seek to achieve universal health coverage, and that in the process, they actually address health systems challenges that we know and deal with every day. And we don't end up with the gadgets that are useful and fancy, but are not necessarily addressing the needs of the community. The community sitting in those spaces will also ensure that the strategies and policies are people-centered and respect human rights and are adaptable to different contexts and settings. And participation, especially of key populations and vulnerable groups, will ensure that special needs, unique issues, universal coverage are included in the strategy and policies, because it's useless for us to talk about universal access if we don't ensure that it appears strongly in the national strategies. The next issue is the issue of the digital divide, which we know exists between countries in the north and in the south, between populations, between genders, between vulnerable populations and the rest of the world. And it is important that we ensure that we have community participation in those spaces. Because as we know, digital solutions in themselves are not neutral. They are developed in a context defined by inequalities, race, gender, location, and economic status, and are all interrelated data points defining inequality. And we have seen from the Mobile Gender Report that more than 300 million fewer women than men access internet or mobile internet. And women are 8% less likely than men to own a mobile phone. And we know this because sometimes when we want to reach women, they will tell us to reach them either during the weekend or after hours when the husband is at home, because the husband is the one who carries the cell phone. And so civil society organizations can play a critical role of mobilizing and advocating to narrow this digital divide. We have also issues around data management, protection, and security, particularly against issues of misinformation, cyber bullying, fraud, racism, human rights violations. And we know community activist groups can hold governments and digital health developers and user companies to account to ensure data protection, security, appropriate use and ownership of health data, and to ensure that governments have developed and adopted legal and ethical frameworks that assure patient safety, privacy of data and protection. The issue of equity in access to digital technology and resources is a critical one, so that no one is left behind. And we also know that civil society can play a critical part here as digital health champions. They can advocate for equity, and they can ensure that all vulnerable groups have equal access to digital technology. Groups such as sex workers, LGBTI, and people with disabilities are normally left behind due to lack of access to smartphones, data, and internet. And CSOs that have access to these groups can actually improve their access to technology, as we saw during the COVID era at its peak. The issue of rights and individuals at the center of digital health system structures and delivery is also a critical one, where communities can play a watchdog role of ensuring that the individual must never be overshadowed by technical processes. They can only do this effectively when they are involved from the design and development to the rollout stages of the innovation, not when they come towards the end, when the innovation is already being launched. At the process of evaluation, we also see an important role for communities, the way they need to be involved, not just as participants of evaluation, but as part of the evaluation teams, because it is also in the community interest that they see that the outcomes of universal access, improved disease management, and improvement in health systems are achieved. The last area is that of managing digital waste on health, managing digital waste on health and the environment. We know civil society pressure groups can play an important watchdog role to hold companies to account on waste disposal. As we speak, we know that the issue of the obsolete equipment such as cell phones is already a growing concern. We've seen pictures of piles and piles of old phones that are just lying all over the place. It would not be fair for me to complete this presentation without emphasizing the fact that communities can only effectively play this role if we ensure that we've addressed their own challenges, because the community themselves are often left behind in information and technology to make participation meaningful. Most of the time, they do not know about any technology being designed until it is already in the hospitals or they see it on the patients themselves. And many of the civil society organizations lack basic digital skills. Equipment is usually old or even not there. The cost of data is prohibitive. And access to information, digital health is a fairly new topic for many of the communities. And they had to reach communities, there's no internet, and they have to travel long distances to access. As frontline aides, when COVID started, we had to create an emergency grant to support and give out to communities some of the basic equipment to enable them to go on virtual conversation with the rest of the world. I just want to conclude by saying that as the world gets flooded by digital healthcare systems, it is important that we remember, as they said by WHO, we must make sure that innovation and technology helps to reduce inequalities in our world instead of becoming another reason people are left behind. I thank you.
Thank you, Louis. I hope you heard the audience applaud you to your wonderful presentation. And I think you are right. We have to really focus also on digital equipment, because there's inequality danger as well. So thank you for this impulse. I'm just looking here into the audience if there's a direct question to you, which I cannot see. So please stay online because we're going to later continue with the discussion. So I would like to announce the next speaker. This is Dr. Christoph Zinder. He is director of Christoph Zinder has been a member of the managing board of Siemens Healthineers since October 2019. He joined the healthcare business of Siemens in 1998 as a segment manager and served in the device management positions with increasing responsibilities within the, I would say, MRI business unit. So you are a Siemens guy all the way through for many years, and you have the floor. And, oh, by the way, sorry, almost forgot. His talk will be Data is the Penicillin of the 21st Century.
Thank you very much.
No problem. Okay, here's the Siemens guy, and I have, of course, a few slides. But thank you very much, Professor Ullmann, Andrew, and it's a great honor to be here, and thanks for having me today as well. So in my short impulse presentation, I would like to talk about data. Yeah, and I hope I'm going to bring this forward here. Can you move this forward then, please? It's working. When we look very quickly, talking about data, I would like to go back into the last century where an important discovery was made. And what we see here is bacteria. And we know bacteria, you know, were a problem or had been a problem for forever on the globe. And there was an interesting invention in the past century. After 2 weeks of vacation, which proves, by the way, that vacation can be very good, it was an accidental discovery of an innovation from Alexander Fleming in 1928. And he, by accident, discovered penicillin and found out, you know, in a petri dish that if you have Staphylococcus bacteria in the petri dish and you add mold spores, the bacteria die. So this was the beginning, and it's very interesting what we have heard already from the former impulse presentations. It's interesting, penicillin was there forever because it was really already there. It was not a new chemical substance. The discovery went into an innovation because, as we learned already, it generated acceptability very quickly because it helped the big problem. It was affordable at the end, was not expensive. And of course, it was scalable, meaning availability could be ensured very quickly. So innovation at the end, if it's done like this, can really ensure accessibility. And I think we have heard now how important this is for the world, given SDG 3 and the fact that more than 50% of the world population have no access to care. What are our challenges as we see them currently on the globe? I mean, there is a steep population growth, probably approximately 8 billion people on the globe, steeply rising. And secondly, climate change. I think I don't need to go into this. We are all very much aware about the urgency. Chronic diseases, where the pandemic plays through long COVID symptoms now also a role. So that's a big topic on the globe as well, with a huge financial impact. And then of course, what is driving us very much is also the shortage of medical staff on the globe. So please, 18 million professionals will be short. And we talk really not a long period of time, we talk about 2030. So the time is really running. If we move on, the pandemic has driven, as we all know, digitalization maximally, and we all learned now very quickly what the advantages and maybe here and there disadvantages are. But it's fair to say we are sitting on data we need to use, and data is the penicillin in that comparison of the 21st century. So it has driven a lot, like telehealth. You have seen a factor of 38 times telehealth, teleconsultation visits. We have heard about this a second ago, And I think everybody recognizes now also the value of applications instead of paper and so forth. Where do we stand today? Very quickly, what is important to us is not only the digitalization, but if you want to bring really medical care into rural areas, into areas we have heard about, it needs also different thinking when we design modalities, when we design lab analyzers, when we design image modalities. They need to be small, they need to be easy to be installed, they need to be robust against brownouts in electricity and so forth. Very promising going forward, and we have really a heavy research focus on AI, artificial intelligence, to help also accessibility to care, because at the end, you can expect in rural areas also less experience reading, for example, an MR or CT image or whatever lab result. So using artificial intelligence to help here and to pointing on symptoms or even find out the diagnosis can be extremely helpful in these areas as well. So digitalization for us, a clear statement, is here to stay and drives what I name technology, in that sense that we can combine technology and knowledge in a meaningful fashion. What you see here on the left is a robot, an intravascular, minimally invasive robot. And what you see on the right side is a medical doctor sitting 32 kilometers away in the Apex Heart Institute in India. So a very exciting trial, and it worked out successfully. So that's a way where you can bring really expertise into areas where you typically don't have this expertise. Of course, you can also conceive such a thing transcontinental. So the near future we are working on is clearly integrated diagnostics and precision therapy or individualized therapy, meaning we are using the data, multiple data sources, longitudinal data from human beings in order to come to better therapeutic stratifications. And the goal we are really keen on is realizing at the end the patient twin, meaning we use the data, longitudinal data, in order to create a complete digital model of a human being, of an individualized human or an individuum, and using it for therapeutic simulations, for example, avoiding or differentiating non-responders from responders. So at the end, it's very much getting from sick care to healthcare by using the data, but we still need to use the data. And this is a lot of work to do, but actionable data in our understanding is the key in order to solve these challenges. And short request, I mean, what we need to build is really a global digital infrastructure. We need to collaborate. We have heard this already here a couple of times. Collaboration is key because the COVID-19 pandemic is not the only pandemic. All stakeholders need to come together. We have heard this as well. I can only emphasize to the policymakers, they play an essential role and can really help us, and they are helping us already by ensuring access to data. So getting out of siloed data and using data, in particular high quality data, which is not a given. Data sharing across the borders is super important. Gain citizens' trust. We have heard this as well. I'm totally convinced when you look to Finland and Estonia and other countries, you can learn how you can really drive trust in this, in the population. And trust is a prerequisite that we can really win people using digital technologies. And I'm personally very excited about the European Union's initiative about the European health data space, which is a great initiative in my point of view. It needs to be started now. And then I talked already about collaboration. And with this, I would like to repeat again, data is the penicillin of the 21st century. Thank you very much.
Christoph, thank you very much for that very nice comparison, penicillin and data. But as infectious disease, we all know we have multi-drug resistance, and penicillin resistance is there. So we also have to further develop the data, of course, for the future. So again, my next question to the audience, is there an urgent question to Christoph and his impulse? There's no hand. So I would like to come to the final panelist in this group. This is Gabriela Cuevas Barón. She is a former member of parliament at the Mexican Congress. She has been actively involved in the UN initiatives. In 2017, she became the youngest and second woman president of the Interparliamentary Union and is presently honorary president of the IPU. She is a member of the UHC Movement Political Advisor Panel of UHC 2030 Steering Committee, and she's also a member of UNITE, which of course is always good to have. And she will give us an impulse on accelerating political leadership for UHC universal health coverage through digital health for sustainable and agile health system. Gabriela, it's your floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much to UNITE. Ricardo, thank you so much for the invitation to be here at the World Health Summit. It's great to be finally traveling and having such a warm room. I think we all forgot how it's to be meeting in person. Thank you, Professor Ullmann, and congratulations for your re-election to the German Bundestag. You are a much needed voice of evidence-based policies in current global policies. Thanks also for your leadership at UNITE. This summit represents the best in global development, a democratic stage. Here we can see students, scientists, politicians, and we are all at the same stage and thinking with a healthier and more prosperous world. I will be short and synthetic in my speech. I will address as a former MP, as a UNITE member and co-chair of the UHC 2030 Steering Committee. The coronavirus disease pandemic, which started as an outbreak in one country and very quickly traveled around the world, makes a strong case for investment in global public health and has resurrected the debate of universal health coverage. What could have happened if the world had done their homework many years ago and people would have access to health? If we could erase those memories from our brain of people that were not able to reach a hospital, or those who have money as the decision between life or death. An estimated 400 million people around the world that lacks access to basic health services. Each year, close to 100 million people are pushed into extreme poverty because they have to cover their own health costs. And these numbers are increasing with the pandemic. People are losing jobs, health insurance, and health expenditures rise due to the COVID-19 related spending on testing, treatment, vaccines. To shift to value-based healthcare, it's fundamental to achieving UHC objectives of quality healthcare, financial protection, and equitable access to healthcare. These systems are already stretched, riddled with chronic diseases and complex comorbidities that have been further exacerbated by COVID-19. It is crucial to optimize the efficiency of health systems and deliver patient-centric care where the focus is on health outcomes that truly matter to the patient and society, as we have mentioned many times during this panel, in our communities. To achieve this, here are three ways where value-based healthcare can enable UHC in a post-pandemic recovery world. According to WHO Global Strategy on Digital Health for 2020 to 2025, digital health technologies will shape the future of global health. But the roadmap to better health and well-being requires a limited but always available resource: political leadership. The discussion I want to bring is not only one that realizes digital health technologies as a goal, but as a means to a more just, more equal, and more free societies. And this is a two-way street. There are three components where universal health coverage through digital health innovations could boost the economic, educational, and cultural stance of a village, country, or even a region. The first component is a political one. We need clear political roadmaps on how these concepts that we discuss in this room can lead to global health equity. As policymakers, we need to be clear on what are these strategies. The elected officials, I used to be one, so perhaps I have this conversation too often, have the power to connect with constituencies. Parliamentarians are the people's representatives, and therefore to achieve UHC through digital transformation, we need to be clear that we need political leadership regarding public investment, procurement, and the standardization to create an interoperable digital health ecosystem at the national and international levels. This can be done through multi-sectoral partnerships like this stage and also with global networks like UNITE. Again, the political component is not only about narratives, it's about political will, it's about decisions. The second component, science is the best army we have for the global goals and for health and well-being for all in particular. Let's be clear, not all parliaments and legislative bodies have been legislating on scientific-based evidence. Data-driven approaches should be at the heart of decision-making processes for parliamentarians, but also for their staff. And it is not only about having some statistics, this is about the way that we take decisions. We cannot afford to have more politicians that are fighting reality every day. We need to design better policies to be more efficient in the way that we use budget, and of course, to have more precise evaluations. Throughout the global effort to mitigate the spread of COVID-19, many traditional services have rapidly pivoted towards innovative remote access health. There are many patients and community-led services that needed to act swiftly on finding a strong response. Whether this would serve people living with HIV/AIDS, TB, malaria, viral hepatitis, we realized that fragile health systems were suffering the most due to the concrete lack of data. And in high-income countries, data coordination and data governance was not even discussed. The value of digital health in advancing the UHC agenda has increasingly been validated by support from the World Health Organization, who agreed on the mandate for digital health as a tool for advancing UHC. And lastly, of course, the third component, the power of the purse. Parliamentarians and political leaders are the ones who can change laws, change budgets, and influence policies. In one side, we have the legal framework. We need a good environment for innovation, and at the same time, an environment that protects the patients, their data, et cetera. But another defining pillar of UHC involves ensuring that populations can receive the health services they need without suffering financial hardship. We can hear a lot of political narratives talking about how health is so important for our politicians. But let's be clear, true love is only shown in budget. If health is not truly reflected in budget, that's blah, 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 and we should change our votes. We need more dialogue between parliamentary champions and the relevant budget committees at various stages of the budget cycle, which is key in strengthening oversight. I believe in politicians in terms that they can change the world. It is at the national, at regional, local levels, and of course, from the international sphere. It is about politicians where we can make that bridge between international commitments and local realities. Yes, we do need all stakeholders to working at the same table with the sharing hands and hearts, but we need political will because that's the space where a community is really organized. And this is why under my leadership with Professor Justin Kooning from Australia, the UHC 2030 co-chairs, in partnerships with European Parliamentary Forum for Sexual and Reproductive Rights, launched recently the publication Parliamentarian Guide, Six Action Steps to Achieve Universal Health Coverage. I know that we have a lot of civil society also coming here to this summit, and we're also having a very strong work with our civil society chapter. So please feel free to reach the website to participate, to get involved. UHC is a critical step towards building resilient global health systems, while at the same time promoting more inclusive and fair societies. UHC guarantees that all people and all communities have access to quality health services, while ensuring that accessing these services does not create financial hardship. Parliamentarians have the mandate to ensure that their states deliver on the SDGs commitments for their citizens. Therefore, equipping legislators with the full scope of information on UHC and its ripple effects on society. To be clear, if we don't make a real change now, by 2030, 5 billion people won't have access to health services. Money can't continue being the line between life or death. Whether it's by voting for the right champion, advocating for more resource mobilization for global health, believing deeply in science, or running yourself for office, enabling digital health innovations, all roads must lead to universal health coverage. Thank you very much again for the invitation to this panel.
Thank you, Gabriela. And if one sentence is important, I wrote it down because as you know that we are right now in the government discussions, if we are going to government or not, real love is only reflected in the budget. I like that one. It won't be easy, I can tell you that. So thank you very much for your impulse. I think a lot of people got into thinking from all of you, what you presented. And I would like to now open up the discussion. And first of all, I would also invite the people who are online. You have the possibility online, I was told in the Q&A part, to actually put into your questions. And I already have questions here. Let me just read up one question, because I have to read them first before I really bring them out. There's a question I don't know yet who it's addressed to. As long as the business models around data is greed and profit maximization driven, and we can only see big data are being manipulated today by just a few global players, what gives the various speakers the confidence that this political economy of data usage in health will change anytime soon? So I would think Louis and Christoph could actually respond to it in that order. Maybe Louis first.
I would like to pass that question to data experts because as a community representative, we are even further away from the data where it is happening and where it is being controlled. And yet that data comes from the community and it hardly goes back to the community to inform decisions or for us to know how the data has been used. So yes, we are also strongly advocating that data becomes more widely available and more and goes back to where it came from, so that it can be utilized.
Okay, then Christoph?
Yes, thank you. I mean, first of all, I was talking quickly about siloed data. And I think for the moment, it's not only big players, big tech players sitting on data. I think hospitals, regions, countries are sitting on data. And we all know you have on one side China, which has a clear data-driven and digitalization strategy, whether we like it or not. And we have the USA, where data is clearly related to money. And I was bringing up this European health data space because I believe the EU can be in the pole position or is already in the pole position with respect to the GDPR and data protection and things like that. But I think the basic idea to have a decentralized data storage involving 27 member states and creating a large data lake, so to say, which enables all of us, hopefully in a structured, standardized fashion, to exchange data and utilize data, is the right approach. I can only repeat this. I hope the EU is going to come up with it as planned in spring next year. I think what is important is that we, let's say, look at the GDPR. GDPR is a critical topic. I, again, see this rather as an advantage, and the EU in the pole position with the data protection rules. However, we need to make sure that it's standardized and not, let's say, interpreted by every country and every region differently. I talk about, for example, the anonymization of data, where we have different interpretations, how this is working. I mean, there's a lot of work to do to keep it short, but in general, I think that's the right approach. And yes, I can only agree to the person who asked the question, if we are all sitting on our data and believe, on one hand, it's a lot of money in it, so I will not share it unless I get a lot of money against it. Or we are sitting on it for whatever other reasons, but not sharing it as long. This will be a problem for the accessibility. And of course, the development of AI large scale, no doubt about it. Thank you.
I think also that's very important how policymakers go along with their laws in their countries, and also the multilateral global health initiative to really ensure data security and be clear what is done with the data. That should be more altruistic in the thoughts. So let me open up the questions now here to the audience here in the room. Is there any question or comment from the audience? Please wave your hand and wiggle with your hand, because I have some lights in my eyes that I cannot see everybody. Okay, then I'll just continue with the next question from online, and I would just pass on. I'm just asking the technique if it's possible. Wendy Yaret would like to ask a question. Can we put this online, or do I have to read the question? I have to read the question. So sorry for those requesting an online question. So I'll do this for you. This is from Wendy Yaret for Mrs. Cuevas Barón. Do you see in the biggest challenge for policymakers to speed up interoperability of data sharing within and across countries? Budget awareness, question mark. Thank you for this, for answering this question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Working. Well, legislators at the international level and national level, it's a complicated topic, because we can agree and reach a very important consensus at the world level. But then when it goes to the national sphere, we need all these legislators, 46,000 parliamentarians all over the world, to translate this global consensus to their national objectives, proposal, politics, and reach at least a majority. In terms of sharing data, I think it's complicated to look for something very comprehensive, but we should. There's a very interesting debate, and only the Senate, I think, from Chile has started a very interesting bill. They are going further. They are conceiving our thoughts as protected data too. So I think this is interesting, because they are seeing how our personal devices, how our computers, how our bodies are giving more and more information. And yes, I think it's about generosity, but the pandemic is showing us that we are not truly generous. The pandemic shows us that once there's a problem, governments are closing borders and people are buying toilet paper. So we need to change the incentives and understand the real concept of global health. We are an interdependent planet, and that's why multilateralism is so important. What I believe is, and perhaps from my personal experience, I used to preside the Interparliamentary Union, 46,000 parliamentarians, but long time ago, I was leading a municipality in Mexico City. So I do believe in international consensus. I do believe in cooperation and multilateralism, but we also need to bring new content to the table. And health is one of the most sensitive area. Yes, we were talking about placing people at the center of our decisions, but we need to translate those decisions to real solutions in order to develop new faith, new trust, new community ties. And that's also going to be reflected, I think, at the multilateral sphere. I think it's about data, but it's also understanding that problems are not respecting borders. That's not happening with diseases. That's not happening with climate change. That's not happening with migration and refugees. So, we need to understand the lessons from the pandemic, but also, again, I think that we need to bring new content to multilateralism and to understand that, yes, we have to go back to our countries and make our domestic homework.
So Wendy Yarrett says, thank you for taking my question. This is great to hear the perspective from another region of the world to know we share similar concerns globally. And I'm shocked that Mexicans and Germans have a toilet paper issue. I always thought this was a very German issue during the pandemic. Yes, it is obviously a global issue that is somewhat surprising. Let me just let the people online know. No, you cannot ask questions live. So please write down your questions so we could actually address these questions here to the panel. So now I have, these are very hard names always to pronounce. Olya Golichenko, who's asking the question, how could governments ensure that the key data gaps are addressed? For example, data related to the most marginalized population, including those affected by HIV and AIDS and COVID-19, at the same time as protecting human rights, privacy, and privacy of the most marginalized members of the society. Could funding and political support to community-led responses services be the answer? And I would assume anybody here from the panel up here wants to answer. It sounds more like a question for Lewis, I would guess.
Thank you. Thank you for that question. I think when I made my presentation, I did make reference to key populations and marginalized communities. And I alluded to the fact that the community-based organizations live very closely to these populations. And the question there about whether do we put funding and political support to communities, community-led responses and services, be the answer, yes. Because the communities does hold the power to hold governments to account. And they could ensure that governments put in place policies that address data gaps. For a long time, we've struggled to even find the data to know numbers of key populations in most countries, particularly in Africa. But the reason for that is because of data security. We key populations have no guarantee that once they have given their data, they will be safe. Because we are talking about criminalized populations here and criminalized countries that criminalize being gay and being lesbian. So the safest place that these populations find that they can go to is in communities, and community-led responses are in a much better position to address data gaps because they are trusted by the particular groups.
I totally agree. I could imagine that we could actually take care of the pandemic a lot better in any country if we get the communities better involved in those health issues. So now I have a question come from Ambassador Muham, and then the name ends. How can we mobilize the parliamentarians to push the governments to allocate the budget on health services, as we all seen in the failures of every government during the pandemic? I think Gabriela already gave the answer before, but I would ask Adiba and Ephraim to give their thoughts to this question.
Yeah, I think
your comment on true love being very important. In fact, when I return on Friday, the Malaysian government will be revealing its budget, so it'll be interesting to see. The pandemic has woken the policymakers and particularly ministries of finance to the importance of health, and this is a window of opportunity for all of us, you know, whether in the healthcare sector or community organizations, to remind the governments how costly the COVID-19 pandemic has been. Because, for instance, in Malaysia, I think the government expenditure on health is only like 4.5% of the GDP. And I think, having worked quite closely with the Ministry of Finance and Ministries of Health, I think there has been an appreciation that, you know, unless they invest in health, in public health particularly, it's going to be a very costly exercise the next time the pandemic comes. So we have this window of opportunity to remind them and to continue to remind them, because, you know, as soon as things start to recover, I'm pretty sure many, with due respect to the politicians in the room, will, you know, revert back to their normal, focus and priorities.
Ibrahim?
Yes, thanks. That's a very good question. We've seen, we won't get close to closing the inequalities that drive epidemics without parliamentary engagement. That's a fact. I mean, we need the parliamentarians and policymakers to do advocacy work, to lead by example, to enact, follow up on laws, to put resources, the true love, behind the words, and also to exercise its oversight functions. I mean, we're just talking about data, and, you know, and to increase the trust levels in data management. For that, we need parliamentarians as well. I mean, to instill some kind of discipline, and also to serve as the conduits with communities, you know, and to make governments as we should. I mean, UNAIDS is usually, and the HIV movement has always been about getting us out of our comfort zone, right? And so really working with those that are very farthest behind, the most marginalized. And parliamentarians can also help us in that endeavor, you know, to go to those who we would like to forget, you know, but they are with us. And that's where the epidemics and the pandemics will thrive. And so we need to reach those places.
Gabriela, you wanted to?
Yeah, I cannot resist this temptation.
Yes, of course.
Well, parliaments in general, they reflect the plurality of a country, of a society. But I think in a majority of the cases, the government has enough votes to pass the budget at the national level. That's the spirit, at least in most of the parliamentary systems. And that the presidential system is not that different. It's not likely to get a divided government. So it is known how you approve a budget, because usually they get approved. It's how to make a real change, a significant change in a budget proposal, especially now that we are at the end of the year and we are going to start discussing budgets as is happening in your country. The first stage is how we can have a real influence in the executive's proposal. And that's a direct influence on the ministries on health or finance, but that's a direct lobby with the government. The second one is, once this proposal arrives to the parliament, how to lobby with the specialized committees or the budget committee. And that takes a lot of time, but I think it's possible. And here what plays a very specific role is civil society. It's about how we can make more visible a specific issue, how we can make a cause, not only for the politicians, but for the people that they represent. If they feel that their seat can be threatened, then they are going to act. But we need more civil society. We need more people participating. We need to bring those debates to the table, because if it was not included, it's because there's at least a political reason. I believe that, yes, civil society can make the change. And the other one is through oversight. There are some parts of the budget that are not always included, which are the changes to the budget, the savings from the previous year, or extraordinary income. So my advice is also to take a look to those savings and to ask them to be well used. If it can be to universal health coverage, that's much better. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. And now I have the information who asked the question. Ambassador Dr. Muhammad Shahid Amin Khan. He is World Chair, International Human Rights Commission, just to be precise, because I couldn't read his full name here on the screen here. So my apologies to him, and my thanks to all the panelists, and also to Ricardo and Roland, because we're at the end of our session. I was considering closing remarks, but the time is up. But one thing I think is very clear, and there are two points that I will keep in mind, even though it's so simple, is first of all, real love is reflected in the budget. And because a lot of countries today are dealing with their budgets, the same is going to happen in Germany as well. And I'm pretty convinced that a lot of politicians who are not in the medical field, who were not in the medical field, realize that a pandemic and global health or pandemic preparedness will be now important in political decision-making for the future. We cannot afford a second pandemic as it is still ongoing for the future, and we have to get better prepared. One possibility is, of course, data health. We saw a couple of solutions, some ideas put up here, but we also have to realize that the traditional health services are changing. We're going more digital, but it is so important. And I think it was Lewis who said so. We should leave no one behind, not only in regards to health, but also in the digital health. I think that is really important to make the world a healthier place and a happier place, and to the direction of universal health coverage. So again, thank you for the organizers of UNAIDS and UNITE. And again, to the panelists for this start of discussion, because we could keep on discussing, I would assume, the whole night, but we won't do so. Have a wonderful time here in Berlin. Enjoy your stay, and please stay healthy. Bye-bye.